Okay, class, we'll continue our discussion on primal dual methods. Right, and one of the methods that we have studied so far is the following method, xk plus 1 lambda k plus 1 equals xk lambda k plus alpha okay. So we've talked about this method, and what we have showed is, well, if the second derivative, so if so if the second derivative of Lagrangian with respect to x is strictly positive definite, then at the optimal point and alpha sufficiently small, then it implies that xk lambda k would converge to x star lambda star, okay? How did we prove this result? Well, we proved this result in several steps, but the key idea was to use Banach contraction mapping theorem, right? So how did we use Banach contraction mapping theorem? Well, we looked at the derivative of this particular matrix with respect to x and lambda, and what we showed was that it's a not symmetric matrix. So we defined B as L gradient H transpose negative and zero. Okay, and this was defined at x star lambda star. Okay, that was my matrix B, which is the, well, let me make it minus, okay, which is the differentiation, which is the derivative of this particular matrix. And what we showed was that the real part of the eigenvalues of B is strictly positive. Actually, we didn't really show it, but it's the proof is given in the book. But the idea is, if the real part of the eigenvalues of this particular matrix is strictly positive, then you can show that this is a contraction map for alpha sufficiently small. Okay, and for the real part of the eigenvalues of this matrix to be positive, we need the second derivative of L to be a positive definite matrix. Okay, so that was the overall idea behind proving that this algorithm would converge to the optimal point and Lagrange multiplier pair. Okay, and the important thing here to note is, so far we had concentrated on algorithms that computes x star, okay? But lately we have been talking about algorithms that computes both x star and lambda star, okay? So method of multiplier was one such method where x star and lambda star, both of them were computed in the limit, okay? And this is another such method where that happens, and we'll continue along those lines in today's class as well. Any question about what we did in the previous class? No? So today my topic is second order Lagrangian method. And here is what I want to solve. I want to find x comma lambda that satisfies an h of x equal to 0, and note that it doesn't differentiate between local maximum and local minimum, okay? But we'll continue our discussion along those lines for the time being. Okay, so this is what I want to solve. It's a system of equation. Okay, how should we, by the way, one thing I want to note here is that h of x can be written as gradient of lambda of x comma lambda. Okay, so if you take the Lagrangian, take the differentiation with respect to lambda, you actually get h of x. So what you want to find is that gradient. So this is same as solving gradient of L x comma lambda to be equal to 0. Okay, solving this two set of equations is same as finding the value of x and lambda such that the gradient of L vanishes at that particular point. Okay, is this point clear to everyone? Okay.
Sorry, can you repeat, what's this, if and only
that? So solving these two equations is same as solving for this particular expression. Okay, that's because you want the gradient of L with respect to x to be equal to 0, and you want h of x to be equal to 0. But if h of x can be written as gradient of L with respect to lambda, so what you want is gradient of L equal to 0. Okay, so once I write gradient, it means it's gradient with respect to both x and lambda. Okay, whereas in this case, you are taking gradient only with respect to x, and in this case, you are taking gradient only with respect to lambda. Okay, so this is what I want to solve. Now, I want you to go back in time when you were young, okay, and a calculus professor told you that we want to solve an equation, p is a function from Rn to, not from Rn, from R to R, okay? So somebody asked you to solve this equation, find the value of x that satisfies this expression. What was the method to do that? Anyone remembers? Well, yeah, what was the method? No, I want to solve px equal to 0. Yeah, the roots of a polynomial, okay? That was, so what was the method? Anyone remembers? It's called Newton's method. Does that ring a bell? Okay, how do you find, so this is my function, it's one variable, so this is what my function looks like. This is my p of x, and this is my x. So how do I find this value, this x, or this x? Okay, so this was known as Newton's method. You know, this is different from the Newton's method we have studied in the class, okay? But there is some similarity. So Newton's method said, well, I'm going to take xk plus 1 equals xk minus p of xk over p prime of xk. Okay? And if you run this iteration, you will find at least one of these points where p of x is equal to 0. Okay? This method will converge to one of the points where p of x is equal to 0. So let me rewrite this expression. I am going to define delta xk as xk plus 1 minus xk. Okay? So this equation can be written as p prime xk multiplied by delta xk equals minus p xk. Okay. So if you're thinking about this space, how do you define what your delta xk should be? Well, your delta xk has to satisfy this expression. And if it satisfies this expression, then from Newton's method, you know that this will converge to one of the zeros of this particular polynomial or some general function that may or may not be a polynomial. Now, Now we are trying to solve the same problem. Remember, here it's p of x is equal to 0. P is a function from R to R. In this case, it's a vector, right? X is a vector, lambda is a vector, and x lambda is also a vector. X lambda sits in Rn plus m. And we want to solve a system of equations, okay, where, so gradient of L can be thought of as a system of equation Rn plus m to Rn plus m. Okay? So here it was R to R. Here it's Rn plus m to Rn plus m. Okay? And we want to solve this system of equation. So let me write it in this particular format so that I know what to expect. So if I write this system of equation in this format, what I have is gradient square of L xk lambda k multiplied by delta xk delta lambda k equals minus gradient of L xk lambda k. Okay, this will be my Newton's method for solving a system of equation where gradient of L should be equal to 0 at the value of x and lambda. And what's the expectation here? So what's the expectation here? We want my p prime of xk to be non-zero so that the system of equation would work. In this case, I want my second derivative to be invertible for me to be able to compute a feasible value of delta xk and delta lambda k. So need I need the second derivative of L to be invertible for me to be able to find delta k, delta xk and delta lambda k. That's my direction dk, by the way. So let's look at this equation more closely. Okay, and this I'm going to write it okay, and this is a symmetric matrix. This is symmetric. And a fact is, if second order sufficient condition is satisfied, then L is invertible. Okay, if you want to write it in a more precise manner, you have to go through several things. So, of course, we want x star lambda star to we want x star to be regular, we want the second order sufficient condition to be satisfied. Then in the vicinity of x star lambda star, the second derivative of L is invertible. Okay, that's the real statement, that's the true statement, but I don't want to write too many details on the board. Okay, so the crux of the matter, if second order sufficient condition is satisfied, then the second derivative of L is going to be invertible. That's guaranteed in the vicinity of x star lambda star. Okay, and of course, throughout this, throughout this class, our assumption will always be that we are starting from a vicinity of x star lambda star. So we are very close to the optimal point, and all we want to do is find the optimal point and Lagrange multiplier pair. So the goal is, so assuming that second order sufficient condition is satisfied, the goal is to find delta xk, delta lambda k, such that hk, nk, nk transpose 0, delta xk, delta lambda k is equal to minus gradient L xk lambda k. Okay, that's our overall goal. Well, let me delete this part as well. So let me rewrite this expression as follows. I want hk gradient xk plus nk, not gradient actually, delta lambda k equals so that's equation number 1, and equation number 2 is nk transpose delta xk equals minus hxk. Okay, so I need to find a value of delta xk and delta lambda k that satisfies these two equations simultaneously, and that will solve this problem. It will give me a direction in which I have to take the next step. So how do we solve this kind of equation? Well, you try to do some matrix multiplication, try to cancel out terms in each other so that you get an expression only in terms of lambda k, or you get an expression only in terms of xk or delta xk, so that you can eliminate. So all we want to do is eliminate one of these variables. So let's try and do that. I'm going to multiply this. So I want to eliminate xk from equation number 1, okay? And if I want to eliminate xk, I know that nk transpose delta xk is going to be minus h of xk, so I need to get this term here, okay? How do I get that? So if I multiply this equation, let me write it as equation 1 and equation 2. So multiply 1 by, I want to get this term here. So I have to multiply it by hk inverse, and then I have to multiply it by nk transpose. So I will multiply it by nk transpose hk inverse. Okay? So what do I get here? I get nk transpose delta xk plus nk transpose hk inverse nk okay, this is what I get. Isn't that cool? Now I see that, well, nk transpose delta xk is supposed to be equal to minus h of xk. So this is minus h of xk. So I get an expression that is only dependent on delta lambda k. So I can compute what delta lambda k should be. So what is delta lambda k? That should be, so I have to collect these terms together. So I have h of xk minus nk transpose hk inverse. And then I have to take the inverse of this thing, nk transpose hk inverse, nk inverse. Okay, is this derivation clear? Yeah. This one?
Yeah, why aren't you just inverting
it? Well, we can do that, but so this, the thing that I'm doing right now is exactly inverting the matrix and getting the exact form of what delta lambda k and delta xk is going to look like. And then I will, like I did some trick, I played some trick here. I'm going to play another trick in order to get an expression that is much better than what we have here. Okay, we'll get to it in a bit. Okay, so this is clear. So my lambda k plus 1 is equal to lambda k plus delta lambda k. And then I can substitute this value of delta lambda k here, and it will be a fairly ugly expression, and I can get the value of delta xk, okay, from this particular expression. So what I'm going to do is substitute this here, and then I get an expression purely in terms of delta xk, and I can compute what delta xk is going to look like. So here is, and once you go through the entire derivation, this is what you will get. What you will get is, let me delete this part. So after some algebra, I get lambda k plus 1 equals nk hk inverse nk inverse. Okay, that's what we get after you rearrange terms, cancel things here and there. Okay, this is the iteration we get. So the way to solve it is start with some x naught lambda naught, and then compute lambda 1. Then you have to compute x1, because see, in this expression, you need lambda k plus 1 here, okay? So you need to compute lambda k plus 1 first, and then update your xk, okay? So you start with x naught lambda naught, you get lambda 1 from there. This completely depends on x naught and lambda naught, okay? In fact, it only depends on x naught, okay? There's no lambda naught here. So this expression, well, no, lambda naught will be there in HK. Okay, so yeah, so HK will have lambda naught term, and HK here will have lambda naught term. So anyway, you compute lambda 1, then you compute x1, then you compute lambda 2, then you compute x2, and so on and so forth. You will converge to the optimal solution. Oh, yes, there should be NK transpose. Yeah, that's right. There is a transpose here.
Don't you have to add a lambda k in the first expression?
No, it gets cancelled. Remember, there is gradient of x at L here, so it gets cancelled with some terms there. No, NK transpose is full rank, but not square matrix. What is NK transpose? What is NK transpose? It's gradient of H. Okay, so NK is gradient of H at XK. Okay, H is a function from Rm to, no, Rn to Rm. So where m is strictly less than n, so m is strictly less than n. Okay, so if you take the gradient of H, so gradient of H is a matrix from m cross n, no, n cross m.
So what is make it normal, so if you say nk transpose delta x, then it is invertible, right?
Then it is. What do you say? So you say NK transpose. So NK transpose is in Rn cross N. It's not invertible because this is rank M. Okay? NK transpose is not invertible. NK transpose NK is invertible. But you can't get NK transpose NK here. Right? You can get NK transpose, but not NK transpose NK. No, you cannot. Yes, that's why you have to go through this trick. Okay, that's what I wanted to show you, that you have to go through this kind of trick to compute xk plus 1 and lambda k plus 1 directly from the expressions you might have computed. Okay, any questions about that? So what is the underlying assumption here in order to compute this? Well, I need my nk to be full rank, and I need my HK to be invertible. Okay. Now you are running this algorithm, and it turns out that guess what? HK is ill-conditioned. Okay. So if you take the inverse, some of the variables are going to 1,000, 5,000, 10,000, some random big number. Okay. Because it's, even though it might be invertible, it's very close to, the eigenvalues are close to zero. So what do you do about that? Okay, some of the eigenvalues could be close to zero. What do you do about that? So let's try and massage these equations a little bit to change the expressions in such a manner that we always have an invertible matrix here. Okay, assuming that NK is going to be full rank. So what's the trick? What's the trick to play from our bag of linear algebra? So here is the trick. So remember, the trick has to be such that we are still solving the same set of equations. Okay, we are not changing the set of equations, but somehow the trick has to work so that we can compute those expressions without any difficulty, or with ill-conditioned matrix. So here is the idea. The fact is, if C is sufficiently large, then HK plus C NK transpose is a positive definite matrix. So let me write what HK is. Okay, and what is NK? And what does SO, SC say? Well, I define my V of X star equals to D such that gradient of HX star transpose D is equal to 0. Right, then D transpose second derivative of LD is to be strictly positive for all D in VX star, D not equal to 0. Okay, that's my second order sufficient condition for constrained optimization problem. Okay, this is a recap. So what do we know about HK? Well, all we know about HK, so I'm assuming that XK lambda K is in the vicinity of X star lambda star, okay? What I know about HK is that this matrix is positive definite along a specific subspace. And what is that subspace? That subspace is VX star. So if you look at this is my Rn, this is my Rm, okay, and this only has to be Rn, okay, this entire space is my Rn, okay, and I look at some specific subspace, this is my V of X star sitting in Rn, okay, this is my D space, direction space. So along this direction, my second derivative is positive definite. But if you go in other direction, which is orthogonal to this surface, if you go along this direction, so this is my Vx star. This is my direction that is orthogonal to Vx star. And in this direction, the second derivative could be positive definite, could be negative definite, I don't care. Okay, that's what second order sufficient condition says. You don't need the second derivative to be positive definite, but there is this specific direction along which the second derivative has to be positive definite. Along other direction, I don't care. That's what it says. And what is gradient of H X transpose? So well, XK transpose D is NK transpose D, okay? And what we know is this is full rank, okay? This is full rank. So NK transpose D is going to be a well-defined vector, okay? And for D in VX star, so if D is in Vx star, I want to write it somewhere else. So D in Vx star implies that gradient of Hxk transpose D is almost equal to 0, right? Because my gradient of Hx star transpose D is equal to 0, so this matrix is going to be almost equal to 0. So along this direction, multiplication by NK transpose makes it equal to 0. What happens along the other direction? So what happens at D transpose NK, NK transpose D? If D is not in V X star. What is NK, NK transpose? It's a positive semi-definite matrix, right? It's a positive semi-definite matrix, so if you multiply it by D on both the sides, this will be strictly non-negative for all D not in Vx star. Right? Why? Because NK, NK transpose is a positive definite, positive semi-definite matrix. And it's positive semi-definite because NK is full rank. Okay? That's why if you pick any D orthogonal to Vx star, you will see that D transpose NK, NK transpose D is going to be strictly, actually it should be strictly positive, okay? Because NK is full rank. It should be strictly positive for D not in Vx star. So in this direction, if you pick any D, it's going to be equal to 0. If you pick any D in this direction, it's going to be a positive value. So, yeah. Yes.
Right. And here, so I'm just saying that how did you remove the inequality from here? Like, how did you say that equal? It cannot be equal to zero. This last.
Right. So, NK, NK is full rank. Okay, which means. So NK is full rank, which means this is in the null space of NK, which means this is not in the null space of NK, which means. NK transpose D will always be non-zero as far as D is non-zero. Okay? So that's what it means. I can't write that NK, NK transpose is strictly greater than zero because that's not the case. Okay? There is a null space of NK because of which NK, NK transpose cannot be a positive definite matrix. Okay? But what I can say is if I remove this direction completely, I only consider the direction along this axis or along this subspace, then D transpose NK, NK transpose D is going to be strictly positive. Okay? So with all this, what do we know? We know that, okay, so what do we know? Let me write what do we know. Okay. So we know the following. We know that along this direction, the second derivative of L is positive. We know that along this direction, NK, NK transpose is a positive definite matrix. If I combine the two with an appropriate scaling, C, I'm going to get a positive definite matrix. Okay? This implies that C large would imply okay. This is not the complete proof, but this is the proof is given in the book, but this is the idea, okay. I have a positive definite matrix along this direction. I have a positive definite matrix along this direction, which has the null space along this direction. So if I mix the two with an appropriate scaling, I am going to get a positive definite matrix overall. Okay? This overall thing will be a positive definite matrix. So the second derivative of L with respect to X is my HK. Okay, is the idea clear? Okay. So along this direction, HK is, well, second derivative of L is positive and NK transpose D is equal to 0. Along this direction, NK, NK transpose is strictly positive definite. I mix the two with an appropriate scaling and I get a positive definite matrix. So I want to solve 1 and 2 with this idea in mind that I'm going to pick a C sufficiently large so that my HK plus NK, NK transpose becomes strictly positive definite. So any question with this? Okay, this is a lot of linear algebra in one class. Yeah. Yeah, it can be negative definite along this direction. So you want to cancel. So using the eigenvalues of NK, NK transpose and a multiplying factor C, you want to cancel all the negative eigenvalues of the second derivative along this direction. Okay. So let's get back to the original. You know, I guess some of you may be thinking, I didn't know linear algebra is so useful. You know, it is useful. What I want is a matrix that looks something like this. So how do I get that matrix? So I'm going to multiply 2 by C and K. So what I get is C, NK, NK transpose delta XK equals minus C, NK, H of XK. Okay, so this is my 2 prime. And then I get 1 prime by adding this up to this expression. So I get HK plus C NK NK transpose multiplied by delta XK plus NK delta lambda K equals minus C NK H of XK minus okay, has everyone written the equation? Okay, so what did we do? Well, we started with this expression, and in method 1, we just directly substituted things, moved things here and there, manipulated the equation, we got an expression that looked like a very neat expression. Okay, and we were happy. But then our happiness was very short-lived because we realized that, you know what? HK need not be invertible all the time, okay? So we need to get around this problem of HK being not invertible. So what do? Then we went back to our linear algebra class, and we studied subspaces and whatnot, okay, positive definite matrices, and so on, null spaces. And then we realized, guess what? If I add HK plus C NK NK transpose, not only I'm guaranteed that this is going to be invertible for C sufficiently large, but it's actually going to be a positive definite matrix. Okay? So it is invertible. I'm very happy about it. And now I want to use this idea from linear algebra somehow in this particular equation. So what I did was I changed my equation 2 to 2 prime, and then I added 2 prime to equation 1, and I got 1 prime, which gives me this expression. So in the original method, HK was considered invertible. In the new method, this is invertible. Okay, this is invertible. I mean, we have proved that this is going to be invertible sufficiently close to x star lambda star. So now I can do the algebraic manipulation between 2 prime and 1 prime, and I get this expression, which is fairly ugly. So brace for impact, HK plus C NK NK transpose inverse. So I define my DK to be this matrix. And then I have lambda K plus 1 equals NK transpose DK NK inverse. H of xk minus okay, that gives me lambda k plus 1, and then I have to find xk plus 1, which is equal to xk minus dk gradient of xlc. So this is augmented Lagrangian of xk lambda k plus 1. Again, note that this is, you need lambda k plus 1 to find xk plus 1, and this is my augmented Lagrangian. Okay? You get these expressions by rearranging terms in a specific fashion. Okay? So this is method 2, second implementation of the original problem. Remember, the original problem was I want to find gradient of L x lambda equal to 0. This is what I want to solve. This is a system of equations. I want to find zeros of this system of equation. And we studied implementation 1, where HK was supposed to be invertible. And we studied implementation 2, where DK, we know that DK is going to be invertible for large enough value of C. Okay? Yes? Sorry, it's.
Is it the same C for the augmented Lagrangian?
Yes, so this is the same C in the augmented Lagrangian, okay? Yeah. The other benefit, remember that when we started with this expression, we had mentioned that if x star is a local maximum and lambda star is the corresponding Lagrange multiplier pair, this equation will be satisfied by a local maximum Lagrange multiplier pair as well. Okay? So if you look at implementation 1, we did not use the fact that x star or lambda star is going to be a local minimum and Lagrange multiplier pair. All we wanted was to find x star lambda star that satisfies this expression. Okay? And potentially, theoretically, you can converge to a local maximum Lagrange multiplier pair in that implementation. But in this implementation, because you are using the second order sufficient condition to explicitly in this process, you are, well, I shouldn't say you are guaranteed to converge, but with very high probability, you will converge to a local minimum Lagrange multiplier pair, because HK plus CNK NK transpose will be positive definite only if you are close to a minimum, local minimum. Okay, it won't be positive definite if you are close to a local maximum. In fact, if you are close to a local maximum, this would be a negative definite matrix. Okay, so you can figure out whether you are converging to a local maximum or not by looking at the positive definiteness condition of this particular matrix. Okay, yeah. Right.
Does the algorithm converge?
Well, it will converge because you are trying to solve this equation. Okay. So let's say you have a local maximum and a local minimum. Let's say your function looks something like this. Okay. And you started from here. If you are converging in this direction, your this matrix is going to be negative definite. Okay. So then you will say, you know what? I guess I'm going towards the local maximum. Let's start descending in the other direction. Okay, and then you will descend for some time. You will descend for some time, and you will reach this point. And there, this matrix is going to be strictly positive definite. Okay, and so you know that you are converging to a local minimum. And eventually, you will converge there because you are essentially solving this system of equation. Okay, and a local minimum will satisfy this set of equations. Okay, of course, you have to check the second order sufficiency condition and all that, but I guess just looking at this matrix is sufficient for you to ensure that second order sufficient condition would be satisfied at that point where it converges. Okay, that was a lot of linear algebra. Even for me, it's a lot of linear algebra. Okay, so in some sense, this second implementation is better because you can check whether you are converging to a local minimum or not easily. Okay, that's the underlying idea, that's the key takeaway from this particular example. Okay, any question? Okay, so in the next class we are going to start chapter 5. So chapter 4, whatever we needed to do, is over. Okay, we studied several algorithms for constraint optimization. We studied barrier method, we studied augmented Lagrangian, we studied sequential quadratic programming, and then we studied primal dual methods, okay, a class of primal dual methods. And more importantly, we studied Banach contraction mapping theorem, which is a general purpose tool to prove that whatever algorithm you come up with converges to the optimal point. Now we are going to take a completely different viewpoint for optimization problems. We are going to talk about dual problem in the next class, and what exactly it means to solve the primal problem, what it means to solve dual problems. Okay, and it's a completely geometric picture of this whole theory of optimization, which is kind of in contrast to what we have been doing so far, which is completely calculus based. Okay, we haven't done geometry at all so far, but next class onwards, we are going to look at the geometric picture of this optimization problem in a very high dimensional space. Okay, so make sure you have coffee, enough coffee, before you come to the next class.